Good morning, everyone, and welcome to this this panel. My name is Knut Lönnroth. I'm a professor of social medicine at the Department of Public Health Sciences at Karolinska Institute in Stockholm, Sweden. And I actually started there just earlier this year, and before that I was spending almost a decade and a half in working for the global TB program WHO in Geneva, and one of the areas I was responsible for was the connection between TB and non-communicable diseases, more broadly risk factors and social determinants of TB, and the issue of dealing with comorbidities. So I have a bit of a background in this area. I'm not going to give a speech, but I'm going to just give you a very brief introduction to the topic. Now, first of all, we have two panels dealing with the link between TB and NCDs. Maybe an indication of the importance of this topic. So first we have this session, and since there are so many non-communicable diseases and related risk factors that are linked to TB, we thought it was a good idea to have enough space, so we put it in two panels. This first panel will focus mainly on tobacco, undernutrition, and harmful use of alcohol. And then we'll have a second session in a different room where the focus will be on diabetes, on chronic respiratory conditions, and more broadly on integration. I'm sure we're going to go into the more broader issue of integration in this session as well, and I'm sure there's going to be quite a lot of overlap. And I don't know how many of you will go on to the other session and how much change of the audience we will have. So we will risk a little bit of repetition if you go to both sessions, but you have to deal with that. So I'll introduce the panel to you very shortly. Just a few words of introduction and background to the topic. As we all know, there's been a quite dramatic epidemiological transition going on for many decades, which has one implication, which is not particularly stark in low and middle income countries, and that is that non-communicable diseases have emerged to be the most important cause of morbidity and mortality. It means also, since there are many communicable diseases still with a big burden in those countries, that we often talk about the double burden. Now, the double burden is not just an epidemiological concept, and the epidemiological transition is not just an epidemiological concept, with implications for challenges for the health services to meet all those demands. It is also a very relevant concept for the individual, for the patient, because the patient often needs to face a double or even triple burden with many diseases at the same time. And it is the putting in the patient in focus, the patient-centered or people-centered approach, which was talked about a lot yesterday, which I think is the most important element here, that we need to ensure that a patient that has several conditions need to receive the care that that person requires. And in doing so, will have positive impact on public health as well. It will give better opportunities for managing TB. It will give better opportunities for managing whichever non-communicable disease that individual is facing. We know there is enough good evidence, and it has been consolidated, to show that many non-communicable diseases and related risk factors are also risk factors for TB. We also know that TB can be a risk factor for several non-communicable diseases. It can aggravate diabetes. It can give us medical sequelae, pulmonary function impairment, and chronic obstructive lung disease, and probably also increase the risk of cancer. Non-communicable diseases and TB have shared risk factors. They have shared social determinants. So there is a common agenda to address the two. Because there is this link, it is common, as I said, that comorbidities are there for the patient, and that means a challenge for the management of the patient. There are also possible implications for screening. Since there are so many undetected TB cases, screening for TB in people with certain non-communicable diseases should be considered. And vice versa, there are many people with non-communicable diseases that are not being detected or detected early enough. So there is also an issue of screening for non-communicable diseases in patients with TB. Now, There is evidence. There's quite a lot of the information in the background documents. This panel is not going to focus so much on the evidence and discuss if this is an issue or not. This panel will illustrate what is being done in countries and by important international organizations to pursue this agenda. So this is about sharing experiences to stimulate more countries and more organizations to get on board and pursue the actions that are needed to address the links between TB and non-communicable diseases. So let me very briefly introduce the panel to you. We have Dr. Waki Hussein, who is the anti-TB manager in Egypt, representing the Ministry of Health from Egypt. We have Dr. Jose Luis Castro, who is the executive director for the Union. We have Dr. Rajita Senaratne, who is Minister of Health, Nutrition and Indigenous Medicine from Sri Lanka. We have Dr. Yusufa Yerima Manju, who is Minister of Livestock and Animal Health from Central African Republic. And then we have Dr. Dennis Cherian, who is the Senior Director for Health for World Vision. We have Dr. Ispan Mikola, who is Minister of Health, Minister of State of Security Policy and International Cooperation for Hungary. And finally, Mr. Mike Dunbier, who is the Director of Strategy and Advocacy at IOGT International. Okay, now let's switch to the panel. And the first topic of all the NCD and related risk factors that we'll talk about is tobacco. And I'm inviting first Dr. Waki Hussein, the NTD manager from Egypt. I would like you, Dr. Hussein, to tell us a little bit about the role of e-health and m-health, going into one of the modalities that can be used to strengthen the links to address tuberculosis and tobacco, and what the experiences have been in Egypt within the context of the broader actions to deal with TB in your country, Dr. Hussein.
First of all, Your Excellencies, distinguished delegates, ladies and gentlemen, I'd like to start my speech by extending my regards and appreciation to Her Excellency Minister of Health in Russia for the kind invitation to attend this very important global event. I would also like to thank His Excellency Susanna and WHO Director Dr. Tedros. To bring all this representative of member states from all regions for this important event. On behalf of His Excellency Professor Dr. Ahmed Din Radi, the Minister of Health and Population in Egypt, I am extremely honored and delighted to be among this splendid crowd here. In such regard, pleasure for me to meet you in this special event hosted by Ministry of Health and Russian Federation to accelerate efforts of all WHO member states in taking effective measures to end global TB epidemic by 2030. Participating in such an event not only represents the concern of Egypt to providing quality health care to the Egyptian citizens, but also reflects fast meaning of collaboration and unity between Egypt and its leading partners. In this regard, I'd like to shed some light on the Egyptian effective approach to end TB in Egypt through improving access to high-quality services and our ongoing plans to drug-resistant tuberculosis TB-HIV services. Egypt has come out of this national health policy aiming at achieving universal health coverage for identified target groups like refugees, slum dwellers, prisoners, and people living with HIV, which indicate general agreement on the importance of multi-sectorial response to making Egypt free of TB. Ladies and gentlemen, allow me to mention that Egypt has achieved the TB-related targets within the Millennium Development Goals, with marked reduction in prevalence, incidence, and mortality rate. Also, programmatic management of drug-resistant TB has been launched in 2006 by establishing the first MDR center. Research is also considered to be scientific backbone of the NTB through by which the situational analysis and introduction of new policies and interventions can be made. Among actions which will be taken to control TB, as you all know, active and passive smoking is significantly associated with TB infection and disease. Egypt is using innovative solutions by using digital technology to address the growing burden of comorbidities associated with TB. For example, you will rarely see an Egyptian without mobile phones. Mobile phone penetration in Egypt is extremely high, with more than 94 million subscriptions in 2015, and this is growing. Recognizing this an immense opportunity to TB control, Egypt is piloting an mHealth intervention called mHealth for TB Tobacco Initiative, with support from WHO and IPUs, Be Healthy, Be Mobile program. The initiative will support TB patients to successfully complete their TB treatment and quit smoking use. Such innovation approach reflects Egypt's commitment to end TB by leveraging digital technology and innovations that are already available in the country. Last and not least, our role to end the TB epidemic in Egypt and to ensure all impact, our action must be built on principles of multi-sectorial commitment, equity, adaptation of unique context of diverse epidemics and settings. Obviously, a lot has been achieved, and our dynamic economy is well placed to attract more and more. Our vision is linked with the international vision of making the world free of TB, and also to make Egypt as one of the pioneers in health industry, to be a regional hub for TB patients who seeks quality of care. And we with you will make the effort to get. Thank you.
Thank you so much. Dr. Hussein. Now, for the audience, we will let the panel members give their answer my questions first, and then we'll reserve some time towards the end. So keep your questions and your thoughts and your comments, and then we'll address them a bit later. So M&E health modalities is one way to address this. It's one way to establish better linkage between care and prevention for tobacco and TB. I'm now turning to Jose Luis Castro, representing the union. And I know the union has really been a champion in pursuing both the advocacy but also supporting work on the ground when it comes to establishing better linkages. So can you tell us a little bit more about, first of all, what are the practical issues that need to be addressed in order for national TB programs to be more involved in TB control and tobacco control, and specifically what has the union done and what is the union doing? Jose.
Sure. Thank you, honorable ministers. Sure, there are some important barriers and challenges that we need to address when it comes to integrating tobacco control and the TB control program. And this will take work, but it's possible to do. The key word is integration. We need to integrate smoking cessation services into TB care. And some of the solutions are practical. For example, the health centers have a TB register and that TB treatment and a TB treatment card for each patient. These records can be revised to include information on tobacco use. The health workers that are treating TB patients should routinely ask if they smoke tobacco. And if they do, they should be given education and support so that there's the education and support that they need in order to quit. The union did this during a patient's routine directly observed treatment appointment. The approach is called ABC, or ask, brief advice, and then cessation support. And in Bangladesh, more than 80% of the patients on the trial quit tobacco and made their homes also smoke-free. In India, in China, in Indonesia, we also saw the quit rates of over 60% thanks to this very simple intervention. Now, data on tobacco use should be collected from health centers and integrated into the TB monitoring and evaluation. How many patients in each country used tobacco? How many were supported to quit? These are two basic questions, and we don't have answers to them right now. Doing this will require some training of the health workers. It will also require that the healthcare facilities are smoke-free as well. We need to integrate tobacco cessation into the training that TB care providers receive, and these activities need resources. We need to make sure that we invest adequately to make these changes. And lastly, we need to use e-health and m-health innovations, as was described by my colleague earlier, wherever possible. Now, it's important to know that there is no one size fits all, and that we have an opportunity to encourage innovation and the integration of tobacco control in the TB programs. But the exact solutions should look for different in different contexts, and we need to design solutions around the patient's needs, not the needs of the system. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Jose. Thanks for thanks for illustrating that actually there are some very practical, simple steps, the ABC that we're talking about, which should really be an element of any standard care provided, especially within primary health care, for any patient, really, and particularly important then for TB patients. Ask about tobacco use, brief intervention, and then do whatever is needed to help people with stopping smoking. And thanks also for bringing up the necessity of having some data to inform your decision. So in order to provide good patient-centered care, and also for planning, you need to have the data. And recording of tobacco use and interventions for patients is a possibility, and it is being done in some countries, although many countries are not recording anything concerning tobacco use and cessation activities. And it's a quite simple step for national programs to incorporate in the standard recording and reporting system. Now, let's go a little bit broader than tobacco use, and I'm going to now turn to Dr. Lalitha Semaratne from Sri Lanka and ask a little bit more broadly how to promote the synergies across the response to both TB and non-communicable diseases, including tobacco use, but also other conditions, diabetes, and the other spectrum of nutrition, which is undernutrition, and other NCDs. And what are these Sri Lankan experiences in integrating prevention and care for TB across the NCDs within the primary healthcare? And I know that Sri Lanka has come a long way to pursue universal healthcare and strengthening primary healthcare. So please tell us about what the experience are.
Actually, I will start my presentation, with the yesterday's opening and the opening ceremony. The Kenyan lady, the TB victim, she said the biggest problem she had was finding money, especially she didn't have money to take the chest X-ray. In my country, we have practiced universal health care for over 7 decades now. So therefore, our health indicators are the highest in the region, especially the maternal, the child, or the neonatal health care is the best in the region. And also, we have the state to craft the entire health of the nation. So we have about 20,000 medical officers, 10,000 nurses, about 15,000 paramedics, about 600 hospitals, another 500 primary health care institutions. And also, so that is run by the state. And also, now there is we are expanding the private sector also with the help of the government. So therefore, the TB burden is not high in our country, because it has been properly managed for the last 20 years. So the main problem is about the nutrition. You take actually diabetes. When you take diabetes, actually like globally, in my country also, we have about 70% of the deaths in the hospitals are due to NCDs. out of NCDs, the leading factor is the diabetes. So you know diabetes patients are 3 times more prone to GD. So therefore, now we have set up to overcome the NCDs, including diabetes. We have set up 842 healthy lifestyle centers in the around the country and 946 well women teams. That is because all this time all the curative services were free, preventive services were free, but there was no way for a patient to go and do a checkup. Only the private sector was available. So the poor people didn't have money to get the checkup. So they go to the hospital for the first time only for treatment. That is why I set up this healthy centers all over the country where we do the basic investigation, the BMI, the blood pressure, the sugar, cholesterol. Then we refer the patient to the nearest hospital. And also in the well-being clinics, in addition to those tests, we do for the breast cancer and the pap smear for the cervical cancer. So, and the other thing, other problem was is the obesity among children, especially. So the main reason is the sugar. Today, there is a lot of promotion from the private sector, the sugar product. So therefore, in 2016, last year, we introduced the traffic light system. Up to 2 grams per 100 cc's, we set green. Between 2 to 11 grams, we set amber. Over 11 was red. So even the multinational companies, all the beverages went red, and their market came down drastically. So they had to reduce their sugar consumption, sugar content by 10% to bring down into the amber. So therefore now, this time, this year 2017, we have introduced the tax system for all the sugar beverages. That is, every gram of sugar has to pay 57 cents in my currency, right? So there are some the beverages having 1 liter bottle has about 110 grams of sugar. So they have to pay about 55 rupees additional to the bottle. So that will bring down the actually consumption of sugar products, or the sugar, those beverage producers have to come down their sugar content. And the other problem is the underweight among the children, especially among 2 to 5 years later. In 2010, we had about 30.5% of children were underweight. But we, with all the universal healthcare, we have brought down by 2014, that to 19.3%. Then the other problem is the alcohol and drugs, especially when the breadwinner is addicted to alcohol, drugs or tobacco. Then the problem is the economics of the family. So all the other nutrition levels will come down among the children and all that. So therefore, we have for the malnutrition, we have set up the program called Three Portion. Three means the pride. Portion means nutrition. Three types of nutrition. That is soya, maize, and milk powder. Mixed together, a nice, very tasty product. So we cater to 1.3 million population. That is the pregnant mothers, all lactating mothers, and malnourished children, and this year we started for TB patients also. So we give this all over the country 1.3 million people, 2 packs per person, 750 grams, 2 packs, that means 1.5 kilos per month to everybody. So we distribute 2.6 million packs like that. So the other problems actually is that the tobacco. Tobacco, we have taken a lot of drastic actions on tobacco by Sri Lanka. So we are the, this is the primary cause causes are the lung cancer, the, you know, chronic pulmonary diseases, and those things. About 20,000 people die because of tobacco in my country, about 60 people a day. So therefore, 24% of the males are the tobacco smoking. Only the ladies, only 1%. And now it is coming down with the measures that we have taken about by 4% annually. So we have actually, we are the first in the region to sign the CTC agreement with the WHO. And we have banned actually smoking in public places. We have banned advertising. And we have put 80% pictorial warnings in the packets. And also the tax was earlier 70%. Now we have increased it to 90%. That is the highest in any part of the world. And also now we have, I have taken the paper to the cabinet to ban selling of cigarettes around 500 meters around schools. And also I'm going to bring the plain packaging also of that. And by 2020, we have informed that all the cultivators that the tobacco cultivation will be banned. And also the other problem is about the pharmaceutical prices. It was very high in the private sector. So they have, we have brought it down by enforcing maximum retail price for 48 generics. So 48 generics means it affected about over 400 brands. So out of 48, 16 drugs are NCDs. So therefore, our drug market is annually about $4 million. So we have brought down all the prices. We have brought down very heavily the prices. So, and also we have started manufacturing our own drugs. There is a state corporation. We have doubled the production from 2 billion to 4 billion pieces. And also we have signed, I have signed about 46 agreements with the local and foreign investors to manufacture drugs here. So therefore, we have, you know, every way, we have actually taken measures to reduce the NCD as well as tobacco, to bring down the TB. So therefore, we have controlled TB in a reasonable manner, and we are the best in the region. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Zanaradna. It's quite impressive to listen to this very comprehensive and broad-ranging set of activities, ranging from prevention of NCDs, and a lot of it is through actions that require collaboration of beyond the health, Minister of Health and the health sector. So ensuring taxation of tobacco and sugary drinks, for example. So, health in all policy seems to be a slogan that works in Sri Lanka. And then you talk about issues and actions to improve access, such as controlling the drug prices for NCDs, and outreach activities for screening services for non-communicable diseases to ensure early diagnosis and treatment. Of course, all those actions, as you point out, will have secondary positive effect on TB, because if you prevent and if you manage well non-communicable diseases, you will prevent TB as well. And you also give examples that have integrated care models and with a specific focus in an example you gave on providing nutritional support for TB patients and acknowledging that even though overweight and obesity and diabetes is a big issue in the country among TB patients, often you find that people are undernourished. And even people with diabetes who develop TB are often undernourished at the time of the diagnosis. So thanks for all those good and inspiring examples. Now I'm going to turn to Dr. Nyirima Hanju from Central African Republic. And I realize, do we have translation here? We do not. Dr. Yirima Manju is going to respond in French, and I'm not going to attempt. Daniel Chemtov, please come to the stage. We have a volunteer translator. Thank you so much. I'll stop there.
We have it.
You have it?
You have it. Okay.
You have it. But maybe, Daniel, can you help just for, because do you have the headset on?
No.
No. So if you can just translate my question. Yes, he has it. Oh, he has it. Okay, sorry. No, it's good. Your services are no longer needed. Thanks for volunteering. For the rest of the panel, if you don't have the headsets, we will just have to do our best.
Excuse me.
So, we would like to hear a little bit about the collaboration across ministries in Central African Republic. So, between the Ministry of Livestock and Animal Health that you are representing and the Minister of Health, and particularly around issues of nutrition. So how to address undernutrition, but also how to address overweight and obesity, and what has been the efforts in the country. Please.
Je vous remercie. Je voudrais à mon tour aussi dire merci au gouvernement russe et aux responsables de l'OMS d'avoir organisé cette grande conférence ministérielle ici à Moscou, dans cette belle ville de Moscou. Je voudrais aussi remercier M. Lovot qui préside notre panel. Moi, je suis le ministre de l'élevage. Je crois que je suis le seul ministre de l'élevage qui est parmi dans cette conférence. Et ce n'est pas pour rien. Et dans le domaine de l'élevage, vous savez, la République centrafricaine, mon pays, depuis plus de 10 ans, a connu les crises, la guerre. Et dans ce pays, bien avant, il y avait aussi la tuberculose, mais ça s'est accentué parce qu'à un moment donné, il n'y avait plus d'abattoirs, il n'y avait plus de marché à bétail. Et les gens se prenaient, les militaires, tout le monde faisait des abattages bovins dans l'espace. On tuait les bœufs partout. Et les techniciens d'élevage ne pouvaient pas visiter la viande, les inspecteurs d'inspection. Et ça a provoqué la tuberculose, la malnutrition. Et donc, je suis allé devant l'Assemblée nationale au Parlement et j'ai interpellé le gouvernement sur cette question et les députés pour leur montrer le danger de la tuberculose. Et tout ça, ça concourt aussi à la malnutrition. Puisque dans un pays de crise, la malnutrition ne peut arriver. Et donc, j'ai attiré l'attention et puis aussi j'ai attiré l'attention aussi sur le fait qu'il n'y a pas assez de collaboration entre le ministère de l'Élevage et le ministère de la Santé, même avec l'OMS. Donc ce problème, il faudrait qu'on le retienne pour qu'il y ait une coordination d'action pour trouver des stratégies de lutte contre la tuberculose et contre la malnutrition. La République centrafricaine, c'est un pays d'élevage, il y a beaucoup de bœuf, mais il y a suffisamment de la viande, mais les gens ne mangent pas bien. Et tout ça, il faut voir ça de manière globale, je pense. Aujourd'hui, la vision, c'est d'avoir un monde où il n'existe aucune forme de malnutrition. C'est ça la vision.
Excuse-moi.
Et je crois que chacun peut vivre en bonne santé et accéder au bien-être. C'est ça l'idéal. Alors, ce qu'il faut faire, c'est une collaboration de tous les États, même de tous les ministères, des ministères interministères, agriculture, élevage, santé publique, OMS, et les partenaires pour garantir l'accès de tout le monde à une bonne nutrition. En se fixant dans un cap, c'est-à-dire un leadership, se donner une bonne orientation, assurer donc le suivi et l'évaluation. Et je pense que ce ne serait pas très long, je crois que le petit mot que j'ai prononcé, ça vous permet donc de voir le problème. Tout le cas de la réduction bancaire, c'est que maintenant l'OMS doit se pencher dessus. Parce que les actions se mènent au ministère du niveau du ministère de la Santé, mais on oublie le ministère de l'Élevage, qui est aussi un ministère de l'Élevage, qui s'appelle ministère de l'Élevage et de la Santé animale. Parce que qui dit santé animale dit santé humaine. Et donc, je crois que voilà le peu de mots que je voulais vous dire, messieurs et messieurs, sur cette question. Je vous remercie.
Merci beaucoup, thank you very much. Thanks for making that point very clearly that the, of course, the health sector has an important role to play in promoting good nutrition, and there are interventions that can be channeled through the health sector to address undernutrition. But at the end of the day, if you want to address food security and good nutrition on a national level, you certainly need collaboration across the ministers. Now I'm going to turn to Dennis Jerry for World Vision to continue a little bit on the theme of addressing malnutrition in TB patients. And could you, Dennis, please tell us, World Vision, we know, has been doing a lot of work on addressing poverty-related diseases in general, addressing some of the social causes, and work also quite a lot on specifically on undernutrition with the links to TB. So could you tell us a little bit about the strategies and the experiences of the World Vision in this field?
Thank you so much, Honorable Minister, Opposition Leaders, and respected delegates. World Vision is an international relief and development organization. We work in over 100 countries. As Professor already mentioned, World Vision is working with families, communities, and children to tackle causes of poverty and injustice. I think the unique advantage for World Vision is our ability to reach hard-to-reach populations with an equity lens and address issues of social problems. That includes working in conflict and post-conflict settings. We have a unique model called Behavior Development Program, which is a long-term investment and commitment to an integrated programming model, where it's not just health, for example, in this case, tuberculosis, but it will be integrated with education, food security, education, livelihoods, economic strengthening, and especially economic strengthening, microfinance initiatives that address the most vulnerable women and children and families. So what does that mean? That means we are placed in a unique position to respond to the various social needs, as already has been discussed in the panel, to respond to the issues that impact adherence, for example, or improve treatment outcomes. My presentation today, I'd like to focus on how we have integrated nutrition activities in some of our team programs. I'm going to draw from two examples. One is our work in India, and one is a project in Indonesia that concluded. One in India is ongoing project, funded by the Global Fund, and the earlier one was funded by the Canadian International Program. In India, the Global Fund is called Akshaya, which we are actually closely working in the union as well. Explore the relationship between nutrition, support, and treatment outcomes in West Bengal. This was a retrospective cohort study, sphere positive of vulnerable patients living below the poverty line, defined as less than $1.25 per day. Who were registered for anti-TB treatment in two districts in West Bengal. Compared treatment outcomes among patients who received nutritional support with those who did not. We examined providing nutritional support, which was monthly rations of rice and lentils. Support was given every 2 weeks. In studies in India have shown that were impoverished were twice as likely to have TB, 3 times less likely to access TB care, 4 times less likely to complete anti-TB treatment, and more likely incur out-of-pocket expenses. The risk of mortality also is very high. In our study, we found that those who received nutritional support had 9% unsuccessful treatment outcomes compared to 21% who not provided nutritional support who had unsuccessful treatment outcomes. Therefore, it's reasonable, I think, to conclude that under programmatic conditions, support with food were associated with a lower risk of unsuccessful treatment outcomes. While the results should be interpreted with caution, given the inherent limitations of the study, which was observational. But given the relatively small financial commitment, which was about $10 per patient per month, the evidence that food supply to poor TB patients might be associated with greater treatment outcomes would be vital for policy makers to make adequate provision of need-based nutrition as part of TB. Right now, we are also providing food support for MDR patients, around 1,004 patients in the state of Andhra Pradesh and Telangana. That includes different kinds of foods. Now, the unique advantage for World Vision is because it has, in addition to government grants, it also has private resources, which we are able to integrate with ongoing programs. In our study in Indonesia, it was a micronutrient support project, where it was a double-blinded, randomized community trial that assigned newly sputum smear positive pulmonary TB patients to zinc, vitamin A, zinc plus vitamin A, and placebo. The study was quite interesting. A number of clinical assessments were done. It did show some improvement. It did show that the sputum conversion time was reduced compared to other groups. However, on a long term, it didn't show much effect, although studies previously have shown that it does have. Aside from study design, sampling issues, what does it teach us? It teaches us that integration of nutrition interventions is directly related to patients' treatment, is directly related to patients' clinical conditions. It requires cross-sectoral technical assistance and collaboration. And it requires intentional integrated monitoring and evaluation. Our work has been multifaceted. One, food supplements. Number two, as I said, we have a unique opportunity to integrate a multi-sectoral programs. That includes not just food, but economic strengthening activities that address, for example, those who are conditional and non-conditional transport cash transfers. And in certain contexts where there is chronic acute malnutrition, we're able to integrate this chronic acute malnutrition with CMAP initiatives. And again, a multi-sectoral platform offers a unique opportunity to increase awareness as well as to better integrate programs. Lastly, I will conclude by saying that in our work, we work across a broad spectrum of community stakeholders, and one of them includes faith leaders in communities. And I think that places us in a very unique position where we are able to work and mobilize faith leaders to respond to some of the social and stigma issues, or issues of access and social awareness. I'll stop there for now. Happy to answer the questions.
Thank you, Dennis, for that, sharing those experiences, and also sharing some data. I do think it becomes powerful when you are able to show that providing that nutritional support has an impact on the TB treatment outcomes. Though we should keep in mind that the first and foremost rationale for providing nutritional support to undernourished TB patients is because they're undernourished and they need that to recover nutritionally. And then it's an added value if it can also enable them to complete the TB treatment and have a good TB treatment outcome. May I take the opportunity to maybe remind, if you're not aware, tell you for the first time that WHO has a guideline on nutritional support for TB patients, which is available. And it spells out the specifics on what type of nutritional support is recommended for different types of TB patients. So please have a look at the WHO homepage. I can also add that there is a new TB treatment guideline, which talks about the importance of various activities support adherence to TB treatment, and material support, economic support, as well as food and nutritional support as an enabler for treatment is also now a recommendation by WHO. So you're giving examples of things that are now clearly recommended by WHO, giving more data, and we may still need more data from countries to be really convincing and putting forward the arguments that you have. And that's also highlighting again the need to work in a multi-sectoral way, because when we talk about providing nutritional support, as previous speakers have said as well, we need to have the input from other stakeholders and other ministers and the Minister of Health to get things done. Now, switching topic a little bit. So we covered a little bit about tobacco, a little bit on the nutrition, a little bit about diabetes and obesity as well. Now switch to the issue mainly on alcohol. And I'm going to put the question to Dr. István Mikola from Minister of Health of Hungary. Which strategies that Hungary is using generally TB control activities and focus on vulnerable groups, but specifically vulnerable groups that have a harmful use of alcohol, and what has been the experiences in Hungary so far? Dr. Mikola.
Thank you very much. When the moderator introduced me, he spoke about that now, and the state minister of the Minister of Foreign Affairs and Trade, but I was the healthcare minister in Hungary 50 years ago. I took part in the implementation of the Bismarck and solidarity system. Now in Hungary, we run with a compulsory health insurance system. That means everybody has to pay contribution to a common fund, every employer and every employee, and everybody gets services on an equal basis. That's the philosophy of this Bismarck and solidarity system. We run with that, and we are able to finance the healthcare system as the running cost from this common fund. And the capital part of the finance system came from taxes from the state budget. You know, that's a special, very solid, very good system, a very expensive system. There are many problems about it, but I don't want to go into it. My special field was the infectious diseases and tropical diseases, so I was very close to the tuberculosis and other infectious diseases and non-communicable diseases too as a minister. As for the subject, tuberculosis used to be the number one killer in Hungary a century ago when it was called Morbus Hungaricus. You know, this was not very good for Hungary, but as a past, ancient Morbus Hungaricus. Thanks to the improvement of living conditions, a committed healthcare response, and a well-organized outpatient pulmonary network coordinated by the National Korányi Institute for Tuberculosis and Pulmonology, the disease has become rare in Hungary now. In 2016, its incidence was 7.8 over 100,000, which means that in general, Hungary is a country with low TB incidence now. Treatment outcomes are good, and there is almost no tuberculosis in children under the age of 14, and the proportion of multi-drug resistant tuberculosis is under 5% in Hungary. So we have many valuable data now, after this tragic period, the Morbus Hungaricus. I must emphasize that Hungary is deeply committed to the implementation of the Sustainable Development Goals, as Hungary was one of the co-chairs of the Open Working Group that drafted the SDG program. We attach a particularly great importance to achieve SDG target 3.3. This means that we fully share WHO's aim and support the effort to end the global TB epidemic. The success of the Hungarian National TB Control Program is based on a well-functioning structured nationwide network of different stakeholders. The national surveillance system is mandatory. Through an interactive online platform, it collects data not only on patient care, but also from the laboratory findings too. Diagnosis and TB treatment is free for the patients in Hungary, and patient adherence to treatment is assured by legal support. However, tuberculosis still represents a public health challenge to the most vulnerable population. Risk factors related to increased likelihood of development of tuberculosis are alcoholism, homelessness, diabetes, working in healthcare, being a prisoner or migrant. This is one of the very sensitive issues we have nowadays, you know. Often alcoholism occurs together with homelessness and poses specific challenges in the diagnosis and treatment of tuberculosis. Patients' cooperation with the healthcare staff is of utmost importance. Alcoholism manifests in irregular medication use, which can lead to drug-resistant strains of mycobacterium tuberculosis and an increased risk of HIV co-infection too. Indeed, a large proportion of our previously treated multi-drug-resistant TB patients has suffered from alcohol problem, and their lack of cooperation with healthcare staff was a major contributor to the unsatisfactory result of their treatment. To address the issue of alcoholism, our pulmonologists apply several approaches. One is to start treatment in hospitals. During their inpatient stay, the healthcare team pays attention to the alcoholism problem and support cessation using behavioral and pharmacotherapy. The majority of our alcoholic TB patients are homeless. Many times supplying inpatient service for those without home is felt as a major social help and this supports the collaboration between patients and healthcare workers. After 2 or 3 months of inpatient treatment, the patient is transferred to outpatient care. For homeless patients, most of the time, a special follow-up stay in a healthcare home could be used once the patient is proved to be sputum smell negative, and they can stay there for the rest of the treatment. For this vulnerable population, a specific care model is running with the help of Hungarian Maltese Charity Service. It has 2 pillars, healthcare treatment and the provision of food, clothes, and various activities for these patients. This organization network in a close collaboration with the National Koran Institute for Pulmonology, and if problems are hard to solve on the streets, the patients can be taken into the hospital to continue the treatment. This specific collaboration has helped to manage this highly challenging patient group. The lack of cooperation is a major problem in the case of patients with alcohol problems, and this behavior is often the reason for inadequate therapeutic response. In case of therapy resistance, there is a legal support mechanism in Hungary to ensure the minimal required cooperation of the patient, along for mandatory hospitalization for the duration of the treatment. To make further steps for successful treatment of TB patients, including those with alcohol problem, a WHO-supported program is planning for Szabolcs-Szatmár County to further improve nurse-led and controlled patient services. That's a program now sponsored by the WHO. This is a great opportunity also to decrease hospital stay and continue outpatient treatment at an earlier stage. In this project, a specific attention is to be taken to personalized treatment approach for alcoholic patients. That's the situation in Hungary.
Thank you very much, Dr. Mikola. Thanks for highlighting that when we talk about addressing harmful use of alcohol in TB patients, we often need to look at the bigger picture of a more complex problem, which is that harmful use of alcohol in many settings is linked to social marginalization and homelessness and sometimes use of other drugs. So it becomes a challenge, not only a medical one, but a social one. And when you told us about some very interesting initiatives in Hungary to combine medical and social services, which I guess is a necessity if you want to reach out and provide services that this particular group actually needs. We may maybe in the discussion session come back a little bit more to the actual medical interventions available to treat harmful use of alcohol and substance disorders. Now, I should mention that we have WHO guidelines. WHO has developed guidelines on many things concerning non-communicable disease and TB risk factors. So for diabetes, there is one. For tobacco, there is one. For undernutrition, there is one. For alcohol, there is none. So we have no document yet to lean against, and I think that's something that we or the global we need to address somehow. Now, I'm going to continue now, and on the topic of harmful use of alcohol, I'm going to turn now to IOGT International and Mike Dunbier. And IOGT, of course, is an international organization that has done a lot of work to help prevent harmful use of alcohol and help countries to set up initiatives to address this big global challenge. So my question to you, Mike, is could you tell us a little bit about the strategies that IOGT has been using for advocacy to reduce the use of alcohol as a risk factor both for a lot of NCDs and, as we know, for TB, and how to strengthen the linkage between TB care and alcohol care in the IOGT experience by this.
Thank you very much. Excellencies, honorable delegates, ladies and gentlemen, good morning everyone. It's an honor for me to be here with you today and talk a little bit about what we do on the intersection of NCVs and TB and alcohol. IOGT, we are a global civil society movement of 143 member organizations in 58 countries. And I want to talk very briefly about three strategies that we are using. But before I do that, I would just like to back up a little bit and talk about the evidence very briefly, because it shows that alcohol use, alcohol dosage, and alcohol-related problems are all associated with increased risk for tuberculosis. So that means that alcohol use increases the risk of TB threefold, and it's also a very strong risk factor for poor TB treatment adherence. Simply put, alcohol, harmful use of alcohol is a population level risk factor, and it often is a comorbidity, as we have heard already. So our first core strategy that we are using is to address these comorbidities by providing brief interventions and treatment. For example, our members here in Russia or in Uganda provide various forms of treatment and rehabilitation services to people that struggle with alcohol use disorders. So, for example, in Kampala, our member organization encounters among their patients every 10th time a TB, a person is affected with TB. So therefore, we work in the community with number one, identifying comorbidities and then referring patients to relevant care providers. And at the same time, we strive to link up with TB care facilities and go there to help screen their patients for alcohol use disorders. So in short, our first core strategy is about contributing to closing the treatment gap and helping to provide comprehensive care packages. Even our second strategy is about closing a gap. It's the awareness gap, as we call it. Our analysis shows that alcohol is an obstacle to sustainable development. It adversely affects 13 of 17 SDGs. So therefore, our second core strategy is to raise awareness about how and to what extent alcohol adversely affects specific sustainable development goals. We work in that spirit with empowering cities, empowering companies, empowering civil society and decision makers to understand and to address how alcohol impacts their core mission, because we want to create a world where everyone can understand how alcohol affects them and can craft meaningful strategies in their concrete context. So in that way, we believe we have preventing TB, we have preventing and reducing NCDs, but also violence against women and mental ill health, to name a few. Our third core strategy is then to address a third gap, and that's the funding gap. And to talk about funding, we believe we have to start talking about the three best buys in alcohol policy. These are population-based measures that are scientifically proven, they're cost-effective, and they're high impact. And I, of course, talk about banning alcohol advertising and sponsorship, restricting and decreasing alcohol availability, and increasing the price of alcohol, for example, through alcohol taxation. I think it's important to say that alcohol harm cannot only be reduced, but it can be prevented, and I think that's important in the conversation about TB and NCDs. So especially alcohol taxation is a powerful win-win measure. It helps both to tackle alcohol harm as well as raising domestic resources for health and sustainable development. So this is not to say that alcohol policy and the three best buys are a silver bullet, but it's important to highlight that they are powerful tools that are currently dramatically underutilized. So our work is really about partnering with decision makers on all levels to build capacity and to provide concrete technical support for the implementation of well-crafted, evidence-based airport policies. So to quickly summarize, the essence of our core strategies is to close gaps through tackling airport harm systematically. The treatment gap, the awareness gap, and the funding gap. And to close these gaps, we work for mobilizing civil society and really grassroots activists in a bottom-up approach. It has been my privilege this morning to share their concerns and their strategies with you. I thank you for your attention.
Thank you, Mike. Thank you for illustrating some approaches for closing the treatment gap, as you call it, with a sort of a bi-directional screening approach, screening TB patients for possible alcohol, harmful use of alcohol, and screening people with harmful use of alcohol or substance use of disorders for TB. And we have seen that model working for diabetes, for example, where there is a very clear concept written in a guideline, actually, on diabetes and TB, and similar thinking around tobacco, certainly for screening for tobacco use, and potentially also screening people that are smokers for TB. So that seems to be a generic concept that is very promising across all entities and the linkage with TB. I think with your second gap on closing the awareness gap, you've done a little bit of the job now in telling us about this work, and I do guess that there is a lot of more work needed to be done specifically on the harmful effects of alcohol and the possibilities and the evidence base for interventions spanning from prevention, as you say, to clinical care for substance use and disorders. Now, the panel has spoken and answered one question each. We have about 20 minutes more or so. And I'm going to ask, let the audience now ask questions, except I want to ask one question before I leave it to the floor to ask questions, and picking up on your third gap, which was the funding gap. And I think that question always comes up sooner or later anyway. And I wanted to start with asking this to all of you in the panel, whoever wants to answer this. We have a situation by which, in principle, tuberculosis care, at least the most essential diagnostic tools and most of the treatments, most of the drugs are provided at least somewhere in the health system free of charge. So the access barrier for TB has been addressed for a long time, not completely, we all know that, but there's been a lot of efforts. Now, as I understand it, for non-communicable diseases, it is not always the case, and that is a challenge to provide good services for non-communicable diseases, potentially an entry point for improving TB care. What needs to be done to ensuring equitable access to care? And at the same time, as Mike was saying, there is a revenue opportunity when addressing some of the non-communicable disease risk factors. So tobacco and alcohol are good examples where you can have taxation, which potentially could contribute to fill the gaps required for providing good health services. Anyone who would like to address the issue of funding challenges here? Jose.
Thank you, I think the funding challenge for non-communicable diseases, as you know, have been addressed in many fora. But there are opportunities for revenue, opportunities for taxing sugary drinks, opportunities for taxing tobacco, as well as alcohol. But I think also the governments need to make a commitment in their national budgets to address the issue of NCDs. This is today one of the leading causes of mortality in the world. And it's an issue that every government, every country is affected and should address that with the tools available.
Okay, thank you. Anyone else? Yeah, go ahead.
Well, in our work, we, aside from raising government resources as well as private. An area that we have been exploring a lot is public-private partnership. So that means looking at a like-minded or common vision-oriented corporate entities that would be interested in investing and leveraging the private and other government resources that we are able to bring to the table. So that's another opportunity we will look at. We have a number of partnerships with corporates that helps us to accelerate and leverage and expand our book. So I think that's another area.
Yes, Mike.
Thank you. Very quickly, to build on what Jose has said, I think it's important to say that our governments are in generally not doing what's economically sound. So we do not invest enough in prevention, even though we know that this is economically sound. It's also important for health promotion and healthy lives, but it's very economically sound. The other dimension in this is we do not invest enough in mental health care services. We also know, like in the communities on grassroots level, we also know how economically sound that is and how many comorbidities you can solve by doing that. So I think this mentality has to shift in our governments.
And tuberculosis is the responsible for the state. It's the state responsibility. So we are going to finance these programs that I mentioned from the social fund, from taxes, and from the health insurance fund, from contributions. And there is a very strict, legally determined program how to handle, how to manage this situation. And that's very important because inside the healthcare system, that's impossible. Social for that. It needs the state, it needs the social budgets, because that's a very complex problem to add the TB. That's the state's responsibility.
So it is a good principle. It is the state's responsibility to address core public health issues and to ensure that the funding is there. I know for a fact that, for example, with mental health services, and specifically management treatment of alcohol use disorders, quite often countries do not include it specifically in the health insurance, so there is a challenge there. If you want to screen for harmful use of alcohol in TB patients and then refer that person beyond just giving brief advice, it's often a challenge that the person may need to pay that out of pocket, for example, in the private clinic. So I know in many countries there is a big barrier there for accessing that kind of service. Now I'm going to turn to the audience. Could you just show me by hands how many people we need to cover? Quite a few, and I'll try to make some order. Let's say 1, 2, 3, 4 to start with. Well, you have one microphone. That's the one. And please introduce yourself.
Yes. Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Thank you, Your Excellency, Minister. I'm Dr. Sam Al-Awedi, NTB manager from Iraq, Ministry of Health. I'm asking my colleague, Dr. Rosdi, about his great job, about the e-health. It is included only the TB and the tobacco smoking, and the end result of the this process occurring by vice versa of the how many patients came with smoking and TB, how many cured, and how many forget the smoking and stop smoking. And another question, please. It is, as you said, it's funded by WHO. So after WHO stop funding, what you are doing with it? Thank you very much.
Please.
Thank you so much, Dr. Sanders. This is a good question. So the global expansion of information communication technology present new opportunities for more effective joint actions for TB and tobacco control. So MT Tobacco project in Egypt is initiated as piping supported by WHO. It is now in the piping phase. So it will help TB patients to be adherent to the treatment as well as to quit tobacco use. We will have a skill adoption of the digital health intervention after the pre-testing. Now the project is supported by WHO, but after that, when we start to expand this project, it will be dependent, inshallah, on the national domestic fund. Also in collaboration with WHO.
Thank you.
Douglas?
Hi. Thank
you,
World Health Organization, Director of Prevention of Chemical Diseases in Geneva. So the panel has done an excellent job of showing the intersection between MCD risk factors and tuberculosis, something that WHO has been working together on for several years. We have many strategies, our global action plans on MCDs, and also the global action plan and strategies on TB have shown the intersection and the urgent need to address these two important diseases and risk factors together. Now, I would like to, we're looking at two high-level meetings on NCDs and TB next year. And the fact that there are two crucial health-related targets, the one-third reduction of NCDs between 2015 and 2030, and the TB elimination targets. So I'd like to address my question to the Honorable Ministers of Health in Egypt, Sri Lanka, and Hungary to know how you, in your national development STP plans, how are you also providing then or developing an intersection between your TB programs and your NCD programs, given the proven comorbidities and also the fact that both of these targets have been committed by heads of state to be reached by 2030.
Thank you, Douglas, for that question. Sri Lanka, you would like to go first?
We have given the highest priority in the health services to the NCD because it has become the biggest problem in Sri Lanka. As I said, about 70% of the deaths are due to the NCDs. So we have actually the entire health services looked after by the state. So in our budget, we spent half the national security, the highest is for health and the education. And also that we have started another program for entire student population was introduced the National Health Insurance Scheme. So all are looked after under that scheme. And this year budget, it was extended to all the university students also. Whether it is state, private, or international school, all have been covered. So with that, actually, there is no problem about the finances for MCD or the TB. And we have our primary healthcare very well extended to all the regions. And we had problems earlier because there was a conflict for 30 years in the northern and eastern provinces. So that area also has been liberated from 2009. Now the entire health system is being operated there also. You must remember even during the war, our immunization programs 100% in my country. Because even the terrorist organization, they agreed for a 2-day ceasefire every year for the immunization and other health. Even the programs on TB during the civil war period also, they cooperated with the government missions and they allowed all our health officers, our health volunteers to go along, sometimes with the WHO, with the Global Fund people, ICRC, Red Cross, all those people to go there and work. You know, during how much our population is, the awareness among the health. The best example is when the North and East was liberated in 2009, about 300,000 people marched from that area to the liberated area. Everybody, you know, some people, they didn't have their birth certificate with them. But everybody had their immunization card for their children. So that is how the health is so, the awareness in the country. So therefore we are spending enough money and the awareness is there. So that is why all of our expenditures prices are higher in the highest in the region.
Thank you. I think I'll let the answer from Sri Lanka be an example of the type of response we will get in addressing this challenge and then hearing about the commitment. And let's hope that that commitment is there also for other member states on pursuing both the TB and the NCD goals towards the high level meetings next year. More WHO comments, please.
Good morning, Francesco
Branco,
Director of Nutrition in WHO. First of all, I'd like to thank the panel, and particularly the Minister of Sri Lanka and of Central African Republic, because clearly there is a dialogue between health and other sectors, particularly the food sector, but the social protection sector. And that is the way really to address the nutrition challenge in the world. But I actually would like to ask a question particularly to the colleague of World Vision. I think Dr. Donald mentioned his guidelines on tuberculosis nutrition. I have a couple of copies for those of you who want. But the next step is to develop some operational guidance. So I'd like to ask, you know, in our operational guidance, should we mention the fact that actually providing foods to patients with tuberculosis helps the compliance to the treatment? What is your experience there? Thank you.
Circulating, yes, definitely. I quoted some data. Thank you for that question. You know, after our study in India, for example, after adjusting for age, sex, and previous treatment, those who received nutritional support had a 50% reduced risk of unsuccessful treatment outcomes than those who did not receive support. And likewise, various other studies as well. But we do have very clear evidence that those who received food support were better able to cope up with treatment, days lost of wages, for example, and various other immunity-related issues. So I definitely think, from our own experience personally, but also from other organizations that we are partners with, that it has clearly indicated that to improve treatment outcomes. Therefore, I think that should be one recommendation we should. The question is, how do we do it? You know, there are various ways of looking at it. For example, in Somalia, we integrate our work with the World Food Program, or we give food support at the household level. But it should be looked at a more national level. How do we work with the ministries so that they can better integrate, make it more sustainable? So
that's,
I think
the answer is
yes.
Thank you. Let's have two more questions, because we're running a bit out of time. I need to summarize briefly, and then we need to move on to the next panelist, in fact. So I have one question here, and one at that end of the room. So I'll start at this end.
Thank you. My name is Duhamma Khalimele. I'm the Assistant Minister of Health Awareness in Botswana. My question is with regards to the health in all policy. I think it was mentioned by the Minister from Sri Lanka and one other minister. I'm more interested on how this policy is being promoted in order to enhance my health, because I think it's something that is very good. But then the other question is for the Honourable Minister from CAP, Central African Republic, and it's basically on how his ministry will be responsible for agriculture, works closely with the Ministry of Health in order to promote nutrition as one of the core interventions. Thank you.
So your first question was it Sri Lanka? I think it was the health in all policies, and I think maybe you have described already quite a lot about it. So maybe we can go to the second question, which was for the Central African Republic. Can you just repeat the question again?
Sorry, what did you say was wrong with the first one?
I think, could you maybe specify a little bit the question for Minister from Sri Lanka?
Okay, I was saying, if I heard him correctly, he was talking to the health in all policies as one of the interventions. So my question was, how did they how do they promote that policy in order to get more enhanced by ALU? Because obviously a healthy world policy touches on various policies and, you know, various interventions in the country. So I'm really looking for the buy-in, how that is enhanced. And the one for Central Africa Republic was their close, how they ensure that there is a close-up, you know, collaboration between the Minister of Agriculture and the Minister of Health, given the importance of nutrition in the fight against NDTB.
Because you know, our the health is given very prominence, and also the awareness is very high. That is because even our education is also totally free. You know, as I said, that all the children, even the health insurance for the university students in all sectors, more than that, all the students are because have been made compulsory that they have to get the education. Up to the secondary education is has been made compulsory. And all facilities are being given to the children, because every year a set of uniform is given to the entire student population. Then the set of books given to them. And in the poor poverty region, in the poor students, a pair of shoes being given. And even there are, in the poverty region, actually a glass of milk is being served. Like that, so we get the entire children for education. With that education system, because of that, we are about 97% literate. So the sending the health messages, even, you know, preventive work, is being very, very much easier because all the people have a basic education there. So therefore, and all, most of the, even to take agriculture, now we have given very high prominence to agriculture because to reduce poverty, because that will help in another way, the health, like education, giving more education, giving more awareness, so that means they will be more conscious of health. That way, most of the things, because we have given the highest priority for health and education.
Thank you, Central African Republic.
Merci pour la question posée par notre frère du Botswana. Et je pense que nous apportons beaucoup d'importance à la santé publique. C'est pour ça que tout à l'heure j'avais insisté qu'il y ait vraiment une synergie interministérielle entre nous pour qu'on puisse s'asseoir. Et ça c'est un plaidoyer que je fais pour qu'il y ait une recommandation. Parce que on met beaucoup plus l'accent sur la santé humaine, la santé au niveau du ministère de la Santé, et le ministère de l'élevage, il est un peu coupé. Parce que, comme vous le savez, dans beaucoup de pays, le ministère de l'élevage, il est à l'intérieur du ministère de l'Agriculture, on dit seulement ministère de l'Agriculture. Et il y a certains pays qui ont le ministère de l'Agriculture à part et le ministère de l'élevage à part. Alors avec cette séparation ou cette nouvelle création, souvent le ministère de l'élevage est un peu oublié. Et en matière de santé publique, on met l'accent seulement sur le ministère de la Santé. On oublie qu'il y a la santé aussi au niveau de l'élevage et les problèmes sont criants. Alors je crois qu'il faudrait qu'on repense ça. Voilà, merci.
Merci beaucoup. Yes, I guess one answer to the big challenge of intersectoral and interministerial collaboration is to just create one big ministry of health, social welfare, agricultural and finance, and then everything will be sorted out, but probably complicated in other ways. Now, we're out of time. I'll just do a very brief summary, because we all need to move on, including myself, to the second NCD panel, which is in a different room. So I'll take this last question, actually, as a primer for this summary. The question is, how to? How do you do these things in practice? We're talking about collaboration and potentially integration. between the NCDs themselves, so that's one thing. And then between NCD prevention and care and TB. And collaboration and integration needs to happen on the ground when healthcare services or preventive services are being delivered. It needs to happen between programs, between different public health programs. It needs, because both the NCD agenda and the TB care and prevention agenda is dependent on, as just addressed, multi-sectoral and inter-ministerial action. So it's about collaboration and integration on ministerial and beyond that for the whole society, civil society, private sector, NGOs, etc. Everybody needs to go and get on board. So I think that is really the core question is how? Because we have the evidence about the importance. We know we don't have everything. Certainly we can always, we didn't discuss research. We can always say, yes, we need more research, we need to better tools. But actually we have enough knowledge to know what needs to be done and what really are priority areas. We have, hopefully, highly probably, tomorrow afternoon, a Moscow declaration that puts the NCD TB agenda into the four different areas of advancing TB response in the SDG agenda, ensuring sufficient funding, which we have addressed here, the research agenda, which we could have discussed, but we haven't done in detail, and the multi-sectoral accountability framework, where we talk about monitoring things in parallel and across, including for the TB NCD. So the scene is set. And this panel has been an illustration of some of the activities that has been taken, and most of it looking really promising, some of it well evaluated with good data to support it. And I guess what is needed, ahead of the high-level meeting, UNGA meeting next year, and then beyond that, is to continue to share experiences and to build on available WHO guidelines and policies, which there are now many. As I mentioned, there is for diabetes, it's for tobacco, it's for undernutrition. But what we need to do is also operational guidance and more technical support. And I don't really believe it's WHO technical support to countries, but countries sharing experiences and helping each other with practical solutions. And there's probably a long way to go to fix all the integration and collaboration questions and issues, but I'm very hopeful. Because it's not rocket science, really. It just takes human beings sitting down together and working out the nitty-gritty details. So it can be done, and I'm sure it will be done. And with that, I'm going to thank the panel, and thank the audience for coming and putting some questions as well. And with that, we'll end the panel. Thank you so much.